welcome to episode 2 of the Ben Lloyd-Hughes Show. We are so lucky to have Cheryl, our waistcoat connoisseur. How are you today, Cheryl?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm all right. Happy to be with you guys.
Yeah.
So tell us, what inspired the waistcoat bracket, and do you agree with the winner?
Well, what inspired the waistcoat bracket was sheer boredom and desperation, actually, because I think we got to a point between season 2 and season 3 where it was like the Dust Bowl, right? There was nothing. It was the eternal drought. And Mary actually said something in the DM about like losing her motivation. She was like, guys, yeah, I am losing steam. And I was like, no, we need something. And so the waistcoat bracket was born. I was so interested. I was so interested in all of the waistcoats and how beautiful they all were and how they just seemed to fit so well with each of the scenes that they were in. While my personal favorite did not win, the one that I expected to win, happily ever after, that wedding waistcoat, was the overall winner. And I knew it would be between that one or picnic waistcoat, the winner of the season 2 bracket. I knew it would be between the two of them, but I was really pulling for the Cinderella story with Malacologist. I really was.
And we will discuss fashion on Ben Lloyd-Hughes in another episode coming up where we can dig in even more detail. But thanks for sharing. And today we also feature Mary, who is the founder of the Ben Lloyd-Hughes. So tell us how it all started, Mary.
Well, Cheryl and I were in another DM, and I decided that I wanted to start a DM to rewatch the episodes of season 2. And so I put a tweet on the timeline asking if anybody would be interested in a DM to rewatch once every weekend. And I had a few people comment and said that they would. So I started that DM, and we started our rewatch DM last June, I think 24th.
It's, I was looking at that today.
I know.
Oh, no.
Today.
At the time that this gets posted, we'll just pass it our first birthday. We will have just passed our first birthday.
So we've been doing that ever since. So we'll watch an episode of Sanditon. We moved on to a couple of other Jane Austen things, but that's how it started. Rachel, you started the fan account and the podcast. Tell us a little about that.
Oh, sure. So in these rewatches, we were having so much fun either DMing while we watched or on Zoom. The group of like the broader group of the Ben Lloyd-Hughes is super international. We have people on almost every time zone. And so, of course, it got a little loopy with some of the timings. And we were just having so much fun, and everyone was so funny and interesting that I just thought maybe we should, you know, record it, and at least we could bring in like our close friends into the circle. And so like, I'm excited to share this with everyone because we just love Ben and Sanditon and all the things that Ben does. And we know that we are not alone. So,
and we love each other.
Yeah, we do. We do. And in later episodes, we'll feature some of the other Ben Lloyd-Hughes. So you'll get to meet more.
Dear Ben, I wish my curls were as beautiful as yours. Do you have any tips or product recommendations? Sincerely, No Curls Girl.
Dear Ben, I heard QPR needs some new players. Are you planning on trying out? Sincerely, your cheerleader.
Dear Ben, please put our fears to rest. Tell us you don't wear socks with sandals. Sincerely, No Summer Bummers. This episode, we are going back to school to examine academically the kissing technique of many of the characters played by Ben Lloyd-Hughes.
To learn the do's and don'ts of kissing.
Now, let's start with some research on the topic. Okay, friends. Kissing 101. Consent is hot. And in the couch kiss in Sanditon, we see a nonverbal consent. Let's roll the tape. You see how he pauses and goes in slowly looking for her response? He made sure she wanted it too.
He went 90 and let her go 10.
90-10.
I love them.
Perfect example that consent is not a mood killer. Because that kiss is epic.
Just makes me smile.
Respect is sexy. I love it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's that little, like, he closes his eyes, but he waits the last second to make sure that she's into it, too. Like, there.
And she comes in, like Cheryl said, the 10%.
So after consent, let's run through a quick list of kissing do's. The first is hands on the neck.
Everything about that kiss.
It just allows for perfect positioning.
It's like his hand is enveloping her neck, like the cheek and the back of the neck in the hair, and you know she feels really wanted.
It's just so much connection.
Yeah.
Yeah. Two thumbs up. Well, one thumb up on her cheek.
The second kissing do is the employee of the thumbs.
He's like massaging her face. Is that weird?
No, I love that.
Massaging her face.
Well, and he does that like everywhere, right? Like he does it in the Malevolent kisses too, right?
Yeah, he has several kisses in Malevolent where he employs a thumb. But let's look at this one clip from The Stranger in Our Bed where he employs it somewhere else. Still while he's kissing someone.
It's disclaimer time. If you are Ben Lloyd-Hughes, a family member of Ben Lloyd-Hughes, or if you blush easily, please skip ahead to the next segment. This next clip will make you entirely uncomfortable, just like it's about to make us three uncomfortable. So, Ben, if you're listening or watching, I know you're not, but on the chance that you are, please skip ahead to the next segment. Thank you.
Nope.
I'm so do all of that. Do all of that. Get out and your third glass and do all of that.
And the third best thing, kissing do's in the shower.
Nobody likes dry lips, so moisturize or just jump in the water together.
But also a don't, right? Like, don't be a psycho killer. Don't. Big pass on that one.
But this psycho killer knows what's up.
Right? Like, knows his business.
And he's in a white shirt.
The wet white shirt gets us every time.
Every time.
It's so naughty.
But you like it.
It's naughty in a good way. That is such an interesting shot. It looks like a butterfly.
Yeah.
A butterfly of
it's
fun
really
time.
Cool, actually. He's definitely enjoying himself here.
You think?
Isn't he, though?
All the sighing. It's a tad bit uncomfortable. Well, I mean, it's probably not a new thing for them, right?
Like, do you think they rehearsed this at home?
Mary.
I'm just saying.
I mean, not everyone.
You think this is the first time that they've ever been in this specific position?
I do not.
Well, that is not a typical shower in London.
But it's their house.
I don't know.
I don't know. That's still iffy.
That leads us to another do, which is do use your brain. So Ben shows through his acting that he has not only a really good understanding of what he's supposed to do as an actor, right? We know he's trained, he went to acting school, all of that stuff. But he also has a fundamental understanding of what women appreciate and how their brains work. Women, in order to achieve satisfaction, they are not purely physical creatures, although plenty are, but they are very, satisfaction for women comes very much from the brain. So you have to work, you know, to get what you're looking for. So some of that comes from a little bit of knowledge, right? Which I would perhaps say that Ben probably has some of. And some of that is of erogenous zones. Now, there are 14 really common ones. I'm not going to tell you what all of them are because Google is free. But there are some less common ones. And the common ones, you can figure them out. You're not stupid. I know that if you are listening to this, you are probably not dumb. So there are some less common erogenous zones, though, that Ben tends to hit pretty well. So we're going to talk about those. And you might be surprised that almost none of these clips, have a kiss in them, but they all are probably going to lead to one. So the first one is In Me Before You. And we're going to talk about the erogenous zones of the tip of the nose and the forehead and eyelid.
Aw. With his dweeby haircut.
He's so good at acting like he's in love. Like,
look at him.
Love it. Look at those eyes. Okay, so first up, we've got eye contact.
Okay.
So look at this. This is this is just like a masterclass in what intimacy looks like versus what physicality looks like, right? So the tip of your nose has way, way more nerve endings than you think it does. It's super sensitive. And the forehead is also very sensitive, but it's the closeness. So when you get a kiss on the forehead or on the tip of your nose, or when you're even just very close to your partner like this, it creates an intimacy that unlocks a part of the female brain that immediately makes kissing more, makes you feel more satisfaction. When you get to a kiss. So the same thing is true for eyelids, right? So we've all seen the American ending of Pride and Prejudice 2005, where he's like kissing her all over her face, right? It's the same thing, right? You just feel that, right? So Ben does very similar things, whether he's employing his mouth or not. This would lead up to an excellent kiss, right? Like they're in a good spot. Okay.
Look at Cheryl dropping knowledge.
I know.
The next,
science for the win.
The next one is so on the Strangers in Our Bed clip, that we watched earlier with Mary, you could see with his, we were talking about his thumb on the thigh. That is also an arachnous zone. Above your thigh crease. So like if you're sitting down and you put your hands down right on the sides of your thighs, where your thumbs go in between your thighs and your pelvis right there, that's a super erogenous area.
Mary, did you feel where that spot was? Did you look for it just now? Like I have my thumb there.
So again, never pass up an opportunity to watch this clip.
At least not turn the audio off.
So that's really that. Yes. Yeah, see, so that's not a thing that you would normally think of. But it is an erogenous area. And something else to remember is that not all erogenous areas are erogenous areas for everybody. So you do have to communicate with your partner, obviously, but, this is just kind of a good tutorial. Some other kind of weird ones are like your scalp. So like head massages or whatever. Or like when you put your hands into somebody's hair, bury your fingers in somebody's hair, right? Like that goes
with the neck, like when you put it on the neck and you get a little bit of the hair on the back of your...
Exactly. Oh. Just like in that clip from the Icarus Files, and we can watch that now, where he's giving her the necklace and then he takes the time to employ the thumb. Expressive thumbs!
There they are again.
Yeah, just like signature rubbing move. The nape of the neck right there, right? Oh. Like rubbing the nape of the neck. Rubbing the shoulders like that, those are erogenous zones. That will get a motor running, perhaps. And also like by the ear. So we talk about in Sanditon all the time how he's like rubbing Charlotte's face with his thumb right in front of her ear. And that's because your ear, especially like your earlobes, they're all very sensitive. They have a lot of nerve endings there.
Pressure points almost.
Like, yeah, like pressure there. Points.
Exactly. And then on the nape of your neck where it's like you get a lot of stress.
Yep, exactly. Exactly. And that's why when you get massages right there, it releases a lot of endorphins and gives you a lot of serotonin. The last one I'm really going to like show a clip of is the inner wrist and the palm. So your hands are very sensitive. That's why when you get a paper cut, it sucks. So we can see this really well in War and Peace. When he plays Czar Nicolas, he goes and he kisses her hand there. This is as close as we get to a kiss in my section. Sorry guys, I'm very intellectual. I'm not sexy.
No. Kissing is an whole experience, right? Mm-hmm. It's not just the lips.
Look at that eye contact.
Right? Again, love that eye contact. Again, with the eye contact. And if you go back and watch it one more time and watch his smile, like after he kisses her hand, when he looks at her, he smiles. You... Tell me, ladies, that you do not like it when your partner looks like they actually enjoy kissing you, right? Like, that's instantly makes me feel good, instantly helps with my brain chemistry, like, all of this stuff. So we've talked about the tip of the nose. We've talked about forehead and eyelids. We've talked about the thigh crease. We've talked about the scalp, ears, inner wrist, nape of the neck. Weird ones that we're not going to talk about are like feet, but you like what you like. And behind the knees, but you like what you like. There's no shame here. It's good. But I'm just saying, this is just proof that you, when you are kissing your partner, right? You have to think about what they like and talk to them and communicate with them. And it is clear that, one, Ben has an inherent understanding of what the difference is between the animalistic physicality of a kiss and what physical intimacy. Like, he knows what the difference is between the two. And also that he works really hard to communicate with his acting partners and with the directors and, in certain cases, I'm sure intimacy coordinators, we know they had one on Sanditon, to make sure that it makes sense. The scenes that he does make sense. So yeah, that's what I would learn. So my do is use your brain.
And do you guys remember that one interview where he talked about spending hours kissing hands at Guildhall?
Yes.
And so we're just really glad that Ben paid attention during his classes at Guildhall. Yeah.
I appreciate that.
Yes, A+ student.
Well done. You passed kissing class.
A few of Ben's characters did not make good choices. Just as we learned what you should do while kissing or preparing to kiss, here are a few tactics to avoid, thanks to Jackson in Malevolent. First, do not engage in kissing while operating heavy machinery. Just because Jackson gets away with it doesn't mean you will. And he had a car full of people. That is irresponsible. Don't do that.
That's a driver's ed no-no.
Yeah. Eyes on the road, buddy. I think this is when you know that he's definitely a villain.
From kissing in cars?
Yes, while he's driving. Next, we have him trying to convince his girlfriend not to move back to England with a kiss in a haunted house. You know, maybe save kissing for locations other than haunted houses full of trauma and abuse. Literally, you're inviting a curse on your romantic life.
Good tip.
And exorcisms, not cute.
Solid plan.
It's not cute.
Not cute.
I mean, that he's look at him. He's very thorough with his
hands.
He's
happy.
He's employing those same moves. He's got the thumb. He's got the neck and the hair. The eye contact.
Yeah,
just shows you that even if a guy is a good kisser, that doesn't mean he's a good guy. Evidence right here.
She's like sad. She doesn't want to be kissed.
No consent.
Yeah,
that's another no-no. And then the last clip from Malevolent is actually not a do not. It's just showing that kisses don't have to be reserved for a romantic partner. There are like nice ways to show affection to family members or close friends that you can kiss without being romantic. So here he is, trying to cheer up his sister, who reluctantly doesn't want it at first, but then she's like, all right, fine.
What was that, Mary?
Yeah, what was that?
What was that?
What is that?
He eats her throat, y'all. He makes a growling noise. Let me turn the audio on. Hold on.
Let's hear it.
I killed Cheryl.
I'm not okay. I'm not okay. Oh my gosh.
After this sweet little cheek kiss with his sister. Oh, this reminds me of a bad date I had in the early 2000s.
I mean, I don't hate it.
It's very playful, like, mm-hmm. like
But why the transition from the cute sister kiss?
It was a surprise. Tiger Boy. That's a surprise.
All right. So I think this last piece is maybe a do or maybe a don't, but as Cheryl mentioned, communication with your partner is key. Some people might like being bitten on the neck.
Know each other.
Some people may not be their favorite.
Especially in public. Like,
look,
that's a
you like what you like.
No shame.
It may be a do for some people, PDA, but for me, I would not like my neck attacked in a bar.
Looks she's like she's smiling, having a good time.
So they have.
She's happy. She's good.
But they have their own rules. And now it's time for manifestations. I manifest that the limited sleep you're getting right now feels like a full night.
I manifest that the next time you ask your toddler what's in their mouth, they'll just spit it out instead of running away.
I manifest that you'll always be able to find your TV remote.
Thanks for joining us for our scientific exploration of the kissing techniques of most of the characters that Ben Lloyd-Hughes has played. We hope you learned something today.
And if you didn't, we recommend continued study and research in all of his projects.
Make sure to follow us for all of the fun on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram.